people are not looking for a friendly church anymore, but they're looking for friends. And what I want to announce to you is that you have a friend in this church somewhere, sprinkled out throughout this whole crowd. You have somebody who knows about you, who cares about you, and loves you in spite of all your weaknesses. And because of that person's good friendship, you can be a friend to someone else. But of course, we're here to proclaim the fact that we have a friend in Christ our Lord, who never forsakes us, who understands all our weaknesses, who loves us anyway, and in his kind, gracious, forgiving spirit, helps us always put our feet on solid ground. I hope that this morning you will renew your commitment to be a friend to somebody, and you hold on to the friendship of Christ our Lord. Would you, if you are a guest, let us know how we might include you or how we might help you be more at home in Black Mountain if you're a guest. There are cards that are usually protruding from the hymnals. I hope you'll find one and fill it out. Let us know how we can welcome you and how we can minister to you. Would you take a moment now as we turn to our worship focus and speak of this together? Let's stand, and then we will conclude with our beginning of our hymn. For it is by the unfailing goodness of God that you and I are set free for believing. And this is not our accomplishment, but God's gift to us. This is not as we suppose, by our own achievements, that none of us might feel better than other people. No aspect of our lives remains untouched by the change that comes with God's call and God's gift to us. Christian conversion means to surrender ourselves to God in every sphere of human life, the personal and social, the spiritual and economic, the psychological and political.
For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
We need God's love. We gather up for God's mercy. We sing with joy on God's grace never fails.
Shall we pray? Lord, you never taught anyone to preach, but you taught all of your disciples to pray. We come praying this morning, some of us with heavy burdens that we carry, some of us because we're full of joy. Receive our grateful thanks this morning and be present and be honored in all that we do through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Joyful song tonight, though. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. You want to follow along in the hymn book? It's hymn number 7.
Joy, 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 we adore thee. God, glory, God.
for his testimony to us and for his sturdy, strong resolve. Sonny and Sharon Moore, I have to fight to keep from saying Sonny and Cher, are with us. Sonny is the new coordinator of the shelter, our homeless shelter that is held in our fellowship hall. We're so glad to have you all in the role that you're going to be playing for us. And so glad to hear the great story of the strength of your own lives in Christ. Welcome. We're glad to hear you. We have many things to be joyful for, don't we? Today is the service of joy. Take this word. Hear it today. Hear the call of Scripture about having joy. And then take this word with you home with you. Would you pray for me, please? Our Lord, this day we have a fresh new opportunity because you give us a fresh new day of creation. We're so thankful for all that's around us. Teach us how to take the time to be filled with gratitude for what we have received. We thank you also that we have this place called a spiritual home. A place that when we treat it properly, that so many people can call it their shelter. We're so thankful that many people can come here at the last goodbye, speak of this as a place for a homecoming. Teach us not so much how to pray, Lord, but teach us to keep on praying so that gratitude can grow in our hearts and an understanding of your constant presence with us. Never be mistaken for anything else. Teach us to come to you with outstretched arms of a child. Like a child running to its father for comfort, we come. And as we come, Lord, teach us to be filled with the honor and respect, but also the love that a child would have for a parent. Take our small, clumsy hands in yours and walk with us. Lead the way through the dark streets. Help us to keep pace with you so that your will might be done in our lives, here on earth as it is in heaven.
Thank you.
command is this: love each other as I've loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. And you are my friends as you do what I command. Pray with me for a moment. Lord, we're touched by the instruction of your word, but we're encouraged by what you have demonstrated to us. Your own life, the gift of your life and ministry, and then your gift of promise of eternal life. These are the anchors of our lives. Teach us, Father, to take your word to heart. We might be growing to become more and more like you, our Master. For this we pray. I don't really know how to begin this. I was thinking about the subject of joy, and here we're having to hear about a crisis in the church. And the verse for you, Bill, would be ask for what you will, and the Lord will make it happen. That's what I thought was very important. You need to know about this little crisis. It's a drain pipe, for heaven's sakes. Can you imagine? But that's critical for us to keep us going. And it's not just cosmetic. This is crisis, so be thinking about it. But here's what I need to say to you this morning. I have lost my sunglasses. I can tell by your little nervous laughter, you're a little afraid to acknowledge that you've done the same. But if you have any idea how frustrating that can be in the middle of the summer, this was a special pair too. This was a pair that fit me so well, a pair that my children liked. They said that I looked younger when I wore them. But they were a great color tone, a comfortable fit. They gripped around my head, special frames, and I don't know where they are. And I don't know if you've ever had this kind of thing happen to you or not, when you lose something that you need all the time and that you depend on and that you keep in your hands. Sometimes it's your car keys or your house key or something that your wife told you to hold on to. I don't know what it might be what you've lost, but you know how it is. When you have searched high and low and over and under and everywhere you think you've been, absolutely to no avail. Not only do you feel like the biggest fool in the world, but you feel like you're losing your mind. And I mean, you know, the world suddenly is just in turmoil. It's tragic. It's the beginning of the end of all possible hope for you. It's terrible. But let me change gears a minute. What if you lost your joy as a Christian? And there's no longer a sweet spirit in the gathering. Or it's been replaced by an entangled kind of relational confusion, or there's a sense of duty about it, or it's just dry as dust, or it's a compulsion, or a necessary habit, or a requirement only. Do you know what I mean when I say that? And of course you do. Because many people have lost their joy at being a Christian, at working at being Christian. And many people have lost their joy about going to church or even trusting in God or having any faith at all or applying it to the critical areas of their lives. You may have heard the story of the little boy who was always challenged to wash his hands carefully before he came to the dinner table, and he finally blew up and said to his mama, germs and Jesus, that's all I ever hear about, and I ain't never seen nothing beat one of them. Charlie Shedd lived on the nearest island to us in Georgia, Jekyll Island. He pastored the little Presbyterian church there. And he told a story about how he had emerged from the seminary studies with very little left, with just a lot of exhaustion, a very academic kind of approach to things, a bit dry himself, but some lurking high hopes of a nice plumb position somewhere where he could start out his ministry. And he didn't get that big one. But he learned a great lesson from sitting in an old kitchen in an old cabin by a little old lady who liked to feed young preachers that came to her country church. Sometimes this little congregation did well with what they had. They liked to bring in young preachers, as they said, we like to train them up well. They had borne well over the years of having an untried, fresh seminary, long years of amateur presentations of the gospel. And they had built strong calluses in their soul that matched their weather-beaten faces. They had toughed it out to their credit. And they raised up a few of these embryonic young shepherds. some of the world might have considered more important than larger pulpits in their days later on. But Charlie Shedd was eating fried chicken at Grandma Davison's cabin one Sunday after preaching, and she decided that this was the moment to really let him have it. She listened to that presentation that morning, and she and her friends were, as the scripture would say, they were downcast, but they weren't discouraged. And so she started up, and this is what she said. She said, "Preacher Week was a hoping that a preacher might know the other side of the Lord Jesus. We've had plenty of doom. That's part of the truth, and we know there's a judgment coming. The likes of you young boys have been blowing that on us for the last 30 years around here. We got it. Always, though, I thought some preacher around here would know that some of the gospel is about glad tidings. Studying that out would do wonders for you, and it sure wouldn't hurt us none either." So Charlie Shedd got to studying it out, and he found out that it was more than true. He found that there were at least 200 times in the Bible used the different forms of joy, and in one translation of the New Testament, Jesus' name was associated 63 times with the word, precisely with joy. And then, of course, all the times that were cheer and merry and laughter were mentioned. You couldn't count them all. 7 times his name was associated with glad, and 18 times the word rejoice appeared. Pretty good record for what we should hear about, I believe. And the truth begins to shape itself as we read what Jesus said about joy. And what was said about him. Most of us have heard that Jesus was well known as the man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. We've seen his broken body, and we've seen his bowed head as he hung on the cross for us. He was touched with our infirmities and the feelings of our sorrows. Jesus understood how it felt to lose somebody, how to be rejected by friends, and why and how he was misunderstood by his own family, and even to be run out of town. He understood it better than we. But if we see only that side of it, we just see one side of who he was. Or if you read the story, the whole story of Christ, you know how he longed to be glad. One day he said this to his disciples, "These things I have spoken to you, that you might have the same joy that I have deep within." Something that's unshakable, that the world yearns for but cannot grasp. "I share my joy with you that your joy might be just as big as mine." So when you hear that, we can no longer doubt why Jesus did what he did, how he felt, and what he did. He said, he made it clear, so that we could be filled with joy. So do like Charlie Shedd did. Study it out like Grandma Davison told him to do. You recognize that joy is no chance accomplishment. It's not just a door prize for one or two. It's not a giveaway. There must be a fountainhead that bursts in our lives as Christians through our faith, or that joy dissipates into a job, and it disappears into a colorless, monotone compromise. There are two fountainheads that burst forth in our lives when you hold firmly to faith in Christ. Here's what you will hear about. You will hear about these two things. You'll hear about God's love, and you'll hear about God's will. But doesn't there lurk in our lives some overfamiliarity with both of these terms, and it threatens to give us a hope of religion? We can't let that happen. So first of all, there's God's love. It's foundational. And yet, so many people have never tasted the passion of the pursuit of God. The God who brings you undeserved love and grace, kindness, better than life itself, is what David said in the Psalms. Now think for just a moment about the best contribution that can be given to a child in their home. The best contribution to their strength and stability is the sure knowledge that his parents or her parents love him. Love him unconditionally, no matter what he does. He's going to be okay, and he'll come back into favor no matter what he or she has done. idea of who God is. And that's what Jesus came to clear up. Any misconceptions about God and all of the New Testament is a commentary on that subject. You can't improve on 1 John 4:8. Most children love it. I wonder if I call on our youth right now, they could stand and they could say it. 1 John 4:8. Youth, you ready? They're working on their kids. 1 John 4:8. You can't improve on it. God is love. God is love. That's the pure source of deep and abiding joy. It sets us free to work. It allows us to be confident. It sets us free from that old existential gnawing about the meaning or the purpose of life or the significance of our days. It is the love of our God for us. And then the purpose of our lives is that we would love our God with all of our hearts, with all of our souls, all of our minds, and all of our strength. And Jesus iced the cake by saying, continue in my love. Now anybody who's grasped that, anybody who's realized the passion in God's love and really lived it, has never been disappointed. They've always found a sure source of deep joy inside. Paul loved Timothy like his own son, and he was coaching him when he said this to him. He said, Timothy, while you're out there working and you're having all these little discouragements and all these little skirmishes in the churches that I've planted and sent you out to strengthen, listen to me, Timothy, he said. Perfect love casts out all fear. When we're free, because we know we are loved, then we're set free from all the little puny anxieties that eat away at our joy. And we're set free from the huge anxieties that tie us in a knot. We're free to focus and concentrate on the real things of life. And then you get a new power in your life. And when new power comes into your life, you feel a sense of joyful gratitude. And when you live thankfully, you can't hide it. People look in your face, and your very eyes shine out about the gratitude and appreciation by which you live. Go back to the subject. Let me ask you this. Have you ever lost this joy? Or have you ever been lost in the woods somewhere? Have you ever been just terrified somewhere and you didn't know where to turn or how to go? Well, let me tell you a little story. I was about 9 years old, Kevin, just about your age and size, another year older. My family came for a little rest in a rough little cabin in Ridgecrest, and I woke up one night in the middle of the night to the sounds and the image of a bear pounding outside. God's will. Say it all. critics of our faith often warn us about overemphasizing happiness, because it makes us lightweight and giddy sometimes in the face of real hurt and crises. And they're right. And in that note, we have to learn something from them, and that is that the number one reason for following Christ is not to be joyful. It is to do what Jesus said he did, and joy would come afterward as a result. He came, as he said, to do the will of my Father, to do what pleases God. And it followed our verse for the morning that he spoke to us that the same joy would be available to us. True joy. It's built on a solid foundation of the intimate relationship with Christ, shedding some of the stuff we carry around that's unnecessary, and picking up what he said was most necessary. The label that it bears is simple. It's called obedience. And make no mistake about it, there's a huge difference between peace of mind and resurrection joy. One is very deep inside, but the other is just a veneer. Rena and I have a big old chest of drawers, or ship robe, I guess you'd call it, in our bedroom at home. It's a lovely old battered piece of a chest of drawers. It's an inheritance from my grandfather in Atlanta. I wouldn't give anything for it. But it doesn't really look so good anymore. All that old walnut veneer is chipping off. But it's a good, solid piece of furniture. We appreciate it, how sturdy and how continually useful it is. It's like our Easter joy. No matter what happens to the veneer, the dark writings all around it, it is nothing but solid, good, dependable. The veneer is going to do us any good. It's the Sunday morning Easter joy. That's the truth that we build our lives on. There's a vast difference also between joy and fun. Pleasure, as we measure it. Deep and unshakable faith and contentment is different from things that just make us feel good. Listen to the word that the Lord said and feel the power that's pulsating from his heart toward us, any believer who would follow him. If you abide in me, he says, and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it will be done unto you. We've all heard that promise, and many of us have long since given it up and turned our faith into a dull habit because we're afraid to ask. The promise begins with a little word that we often overlook, and that is if. If. Jesus is trying to teach us and persuade us that if we live in him as he lives in the Father, all of his power will flow through us. And the level to which we live obediently in him, to that degree, we will experience God's possibilities in our life. Christ Jesus said this, the one who lives in me and I in them, the same will bring forth much fruit. Look behind me just a minute. See the symbol of our faith that's hanging right behind me. You know what it represents to you? It represents what Christ has done for us. But there's so much more. It also represents much more than the rugged beams that Jesus carried up the hill of hatred in the face of humiliation. The cross is a symbol also of what you and I will do for Christ. Every day, every moment, the love of God surrounds us. And every impulse from God toward us is about bringing forth a response. guide us, Lord, that the image of Christ might be made up in us again. We ask for blessings on our time together, short as it might be. And we ask for blessings on our faith and our faithfulness to you. And we ask for blessings on this congregation. So that as each of us is strong, that this church will be strong. In the name, the strong name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
serving the children's meals out at Portland Villa, that had told me that in a tiny little dirty face, about this tall, they saw the face of Jesus. Where have you been seeing the face of Jesus this summer? Maybe a garden patch? Maybe somewhere on the city streets? Or maybe somewhere in your vacation? Or maybe just in the face of somebody else who's been urging you to come and to do and to share and to participate? Where were you finding Jesus this summer? That's a good opportunity for you to read up all the different kinds of opportunities for us this summer. We have next Sunday, some of you have been confused about our memorial service for HC only. It will be next Sunday. Hope you'll spread that word. It's next Sunday at 2 o'clock. But next Sunday also, there's a collection of, there's some wonderful missionaries from Morocco that will be with us at the Sunday School Hour. And their last presentation to us was so amazing to me, how they talk about the tenets of the Muslim faith and how we, as Christians, engage them and what their faith is all about. So that's offered to us at Sunday School Hour for next week. I hope you'll think about that. One of the most important things that we share every year is the Sourwood Festival in Black Mountain. We are almost behind the eight ball from getting it started. The youth are going to be leading it up. Laura will be a big part of leading it up. Linger a minute and think about how you might participate or share or just simply give toward the Sourwood Festival. It's a two-day experience down on the city streets, the town streets in Black Mountain. How can you be a part of that? You think about it. Talk to Laura. Let's stand down right now. Fellowship, and I hope Sonny and Cher will stay with us. Sharon, stay with us a few minutes and let you all speak with them. And my dear friends from out of my past, I trust Robbie will not share with you anything of our life together. Because I'm a different person, Robbie. I want to let's bow our heads and ask the Lord to bless us, whether we deserve it or not. Bless us because of the rich bounty, because of all the opportunities that await for us. Lord, we're thankful for the many gatherings of special people in our lives. We come today because of the meaningfulness that other people have in our lives, but no mistake, we're here also because we have something special to share in the lives of other people around us. We thank you for